This meeting is being recorded.
Hi, welcome to the Zoom questions and answers with the Dogtooth Fairy. So I'm putting these Zoom question and answer sessions on once a month. I'm hoping to run them the first Wednesday of every month, just to help pet professionals and pet owners that are wanting a bit more information about the EmmyPet toothbrush. So these sessions are suitable for complete newbies that are looking to get the toothbrush, use it on the dogs or use it in the pet businesses. And also it's suitable for pet professionals and pet owners that are already using the EmmyPet toothbrush and that want a few pointers. So I've got quite a few people that are on the Zoom. So this is your chance now just to ask me some questions. So you've all got, a lot of you have got your microphones switched on mute. So if you want to unmute yourself, you just go in the top corner. For those of you that haven't used Zoom before, go in the top right-hand corner, you can unmute yourself. So if you want to ask me anything, don't be shy.
Hi, Anastasia, it's Nikki.
Hi.
Hi.
You all right?
I am, thanks. See you.
Yeah, I'm good.
Good. So I really wanted to ask, because I don't feel as though I've not got the confidence in providing the service and I hold back from it because mm-hmm. I don't feel as though I get the results.
Right.
And I don't know what I'm doing wrong, which is why I'm not, my confidence with it.
Right. So you're using it in your, have you got a dog grooming salon?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. And how long have you been doing it for? How many clients would you say that you've got on your books?
That are using the EmmyPet?
Yeah.
I've only had maybe about 3 or 4.
Right.
They've not come back to sort of like, and I explained to them, it's not pearly whites after the first one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I almost feel their disappointment and I don't know how to come back from it.
Right. So are they only ever coming for one session then never coming back?
Yeah. One person's had 2 sessions.
Right. Okay. So first of all, it's about managing the client's expectations. So if they are wanting to come in and get like an amazing before and after, like going from something like this to something like that in one session, then they're being a bit unrealistic and they need to go to the vets if they're wanting that kind of overnight result. Results like that don't come in one session. They will come with some clients, don't get me wrong, and I have seen this where the tartar does come away in session one, but sometimes it can take as many as up to 10 sessions. So what I tend to do is if the clients look like they've got quite a plaque tartar buildup, I would steer them towards buying a block course plan off me. So I sell bundles of like 10 sessions. So if you've got dogs that are maybe elderly, they've got quite a thick buildup, I would sell them a block of 10. And I explain to the owner, it's a progressive, it's a very gentle, holistic treatment. So that dog would have to come minimum of once a week until we'd got a nice clean slate and a nice bill of health. Some groomers or pet professionals that are getting these amazing results from like in a half hour session, I think that they're probably using tools and equipment that they shouldn't be using to get those results. So the tartar scrapers and things that vets use, we shouldn't be using those because only vets can use those under the Veterinary Surgeons Act. And when I see some of the before and after pictures that I do see, I think that couldn't have been done in one session with an EmmyPet toothbrush. So it's kind of managing your client's expectations and having that confidence and belief in yourself to know that you are going to get the results. But sometimes those results might come in 5 sessions. Those results might come over 3 sessions. Sometimes it might be 10 sessions. But the key is when you've got dog with thick, heavy plaque and tartar buildup, you keep those sessions quite close together until you get the results. And then when you've got your results like this, then you still get that dog to come every 4 to 6 weeks for like oral maintenance, because otherwise the bacteria will get in the mouth, you know, the plaque and the tartar will start building up again. So it's that important thing of educating your clients that although the teeth might now look like this, you still need your dog to come in for those maintenance sessions. Mm. Somebody has dropped something in the chat, so I'm just going to have a look and see. Abby, why should the scrapers not be used? So metal scrapers, the Veterinary Surgeons Act states you're not allowed to use sharp. I don't know what that noise is. Someone's vibrating, or I've got some feedback coming from somewhere. Oh, it's maybe Manuela, because it's gone quiet now. She's muted herself. Yeah, because the metal scrapers are classed as a sharp instrument, those are only to be used by a vet, because if you're using a metal scraper, which you shouldn't be while the dog is awake, it's not under anaesthetic. If that dog was to flinch, or that dog was to move around, you could split a gum open, you could lacerate it. So it's just not a good idea at all. Does that help a little bit, Nikki?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's nice to hear when you say, when you see these posts and people have got amazing results from one or two sessions.
Mm-hmm.
I've been thinking, well, I can't get that.
Yeah.
So that's, I guess, lost my confidence with it a mm-hmm. little bit.
Yeah. Have you got my number?
Yes.
Yeah, just WhatsApp me, send me some pictures, because I can often look at a picture of dog's teeth, and when I see the photo, I'll know whether it's a difficult to budge case or if you would be able to work on those teeth in a different way and target the plaque and the tartar differently, just to get slightly different results. So I can look at a picture straight away and I can see why the groomer isn't getting the results, because that looks like it's totally concreted onto the teeth, and you can almost see by looking at it whether it's going to be easy to budge or whether it's going to be a client that needs quite a number of sessions. And as the more clients that you do, and the more of a portfolio that you build up of different dogs that you've worked with, you'll start to see the dogs come in and you'll be like, yeah, this is going to need a block, and you'll get that kind of, you know, that experience from getting more clients. And And it is that thing of putting yourself out there, but it's hard when you've got the doubt, because half of it is the confidence and the way that you speak to your clients. Because if you've got that confidence in yourself and what you're doing, then you know how to speak to them and how to manage their expectations. Because some clients have just got some quite unrealistic expectations, and they're going in and paying like £40-45 and expecting like a veterinary dental overhaul, which really isn't the case. And I would just say to any of my clients, if you're wanting that real overnight before and after, go down to the vets, because you're not going to get that with EmmyPet. And it's kind of, there's a lot of reasons why clients go for the EmmyPet, because they're not wanting the dogs to go under the anaesthetic, they're not wanting it to be as traumatic for the dog, or to be as, it does, anaesthetic does come with risk. So there's a lot of reasons why clients do want the EmmyPet, but it's explaining to them, if you want like the fast results, that, you know, go down the road, go to the vet. If you're wanting something slow, progressive, a lot more holistic, a lot gentler, come for the EmmyPet. But it's just explaining that to them, because sometimes clients don't want to listen. But definitely, definitely try and get them to come in for more than one session. Even if you put together little block packages of five, so it's not quite as, because I was selling blocks of 10, and it is quite a hefty amount for a client to find. I had a card reader at my salon, so some of my clients would just put the 10 block onto a credit card. But, you know, if you're selling a block of five, it's a bit more affordable. And usually you will get results in five sessions.
And Asia, how much would you charge for a block of five?
Going back to when I left grooming about 18 months ago, but at the time when I was still doing the EmmyPet in my salon, I was charging 40, was it 40? 40 for the intro. And then I did 20 for follow-ups at the time. So 40 was always standalone. That was always the intro session. That included the brush head and the consultation. After that, the client would, we would have a discussion. We would decide if that client was going to be pay-as-you-go, or if the client had heavier, thicker buildup, that client would then go on to the block. Now, the block, I would sell for £150 for 10 sessions. So they, those sessions only worked out at £15 per session. But now, with all the rising costs that have happened since I left my salon 18 months ago, I would be looking at putting my prices up quite significantly. So I'd probably be looking at follow-up sessions being at least 25 and the intros, okay, the intro session being about 45, 50. I do know some groomers that charge a lot more. They charge like 60, even some charge 80 for an initial session. If I charge that for a session, I would feel a lot of pressure on myself to get that before and after result. That isn't always the best way to go forward, because if you're getting tartar off the teeth and the gums, and I've already said with the way that I think that some of these results are achieved, and that it's kind of unlawful and unethical, in my opinion, that's how I think that these results are being achieved. It's much, much more important for the dog to instill the health of the gums. The health of the gums is super important, because the health of your gums, your gum line, is your route to infection. So if you've got redness in the gums and you're going in on session one trying to get all the plaque and the tartar off, you're aggravating the sore gums. You're far better to work with the toothbrush on the gums, because your ultrasonic toothbrush, when it's working on the teeth, it actually penetrates 12 millimeters into your gum line there. So it goes that far down to give a really deep cleanse. So it's much more important to get your gum health in place. And that'll happen usually over 1 to 2 sessions, where the ultrasonic waves are working really deep down into that gum line to remove all the bacteria and the impurities. So that, in my eyes, is more important than the aesthetic.
Okay. So the intro would be the consultation, and would you actually do start on that day?
Yeah, so I usually would book a dog in, and I would do the first teeth clean on that day, because some of my clients would travel from maybe 30 minutes away, 40 minutes, some of them. So I would do the teeth clean on the same day. I would do it like a consultation, just exactly the same as what I would do for a new client for grooming. So I sell dental record cards. I think I've got one over here. See if I've got to bind it. So I do these dental cards. They've got little disclaimers. Okay. They've got the disclaimers built into them as well. And I would just use that dental card for the consultation, just to go through all of the details on the dog. So it has stuff about their behaviour, their dental health, which vets there are, if they've had dentals done in the past, and all those things. And then on the back, you've just got all your spaces to write your appointments and your prices and things. So I use that to consult with the clients. In the initial consult session, I would give them one of these leaflets to take away. So that just explains everything about the EmmyPet, so that you don't really have to explain too much to them. You can give them that to take home with them. I always let them see the toothbrush, and I let them see that it's silent and it doesn't vibrate. They can see the piece of equipment, and they know then that it's not going to be scary or intimidating for the dog at all. And I would use that intro consultation session to really try and analyse the dog's behaviour, especially if it's a dog that you've never met before. Because with the EmmyPet, you're probably going to attract clients to your business that maybe wouldn't have come for grooming. You might get a lot of short-coated dogs that have bad teeth that are like, oh, I'll go down to the groomers and get the EmmyPet done. But they might have never came for a groom because they might be short-coated. So the EmmyPet will open your clients, it'll broaden your client base. That's brilliant, and it's great from a financial point of view, but you are letting dogs into your business that you've maybe never met before, which, you know, you'll be used to if you've just opened a new salon. But if you've been grooming for years and years, you've got the luxury of, you've kind of rattled out the bad ones, and you've just got hopefully lots of nice dogs on your books. But when you get like dogs coming in for the first time, it can be like Russian roulette. So it's really important to have a good bit of time to chat to the client, analyze the dog's behavior, and make sure that the dog's going to let you inspect its mouth. Because when the client goes away, they may be going to go and do a bit of shopping and come back to pick the dog up. You want to make sure that you know, you're going to be able to work with that dog and hopefully get the toothbrush in the dog's mouth. And I would say definitely when you're working with larger breeds, not that I've got anything against large breeds at all. It's just if you are a lone worker and you work on your own and you take some of the larger breeds that could easily overpower you, it's really important at that initial consult to make sure that you feel safe and that dog's going to be okay with you. Because obviously you're going to try and get a toothbrush in the mouth, so you want to make sure that dog's going to be okay. And I would explain in the initial consultation session as well about the block plan and about pay-as-you-go options, and just say which one you would recommend and why. And I would try and get them to get a block if the dog has quite a build-up. The reason for that is if they've paid and if they've invested in a block program, they're a lot more likely to come back. So if you say, I need you back in a week's time, I need you back in 2 weeks' time, they're going to come back. Whereas if they've just paid for one session and then they go away, they're a lot more likely to be sort of looking at the wallet thinking, oh God, how many more sessions am I going to need of this? Whereas when they've already paid right at the start, they just come, and it's so much easier to keep tabs on people.
Now, how long does each session last roughly?
So on a first session, I used to put an hour in my diary, and I would put an hour in the diary just because I didn't want to rush the dog. I didn't want to rush the client. I wanted a really thorough consultation. Then I wanted to make the dog feel really comfortable, make it enjoyable, use lots of positive reinforcement. So if the dog liked little treats, little rewards, or if the dog enjoyed to play with a bouncy ball or a toy, give the dog lots of breaks. And I would just build the dog up gradually to the Emmy pet. So usually I'd be wearing latex gloves. I'd put a bit of the paste on my finger. I'd let the dog lick the paste to see what it tasted like. I would show the dog the toothbrush. I would put it against its cheek so that it got used to, you know, having the toothbrush near it. I would then put the toothbrush head against its gums and just all the time stroking the dog, telling the dog it's a good boy or good girl. And eventually I build up to putting the toothbrush head on and putting some paste on and going in and trying to work on the dog's teeth. Now, what I would do in an initial session, ideally you want to be putting paste and water on the toothbrush and you just hold it against the teeth for up to 2 minutes. You don't have to move it from side to side because the ultrasonic waves come up the bristles and it does all the work for you. So you literally hold it against the tooth for 2 minutes, then move it to the next tooth. When you're working with a dog for the first time, if it's a young dog, if it's a puppy, if it's jumpy, if it's nervous, you might only manage 5 seconds. And that is fine. You know, it's more about making the first session really fun and lighthearted for the dog and not forcefully, you know, pinning it down with the toothbrush going, you must have this on for 2 minutes. Yeah. That is going to be so counterproductive. And you'll know this yourself from the grooming. The more investment that you can make into that first session to make it really enjoyable for the dog will pay dividends moving forward, because every session that you have with the dog after that should hopefully be a good session. And I found with the dogs that I've worked with that I would say about 80% of them are pretty tolerant of the Emmy Pet toothbrush. But I think it's because I never pressurized the dog. I did everything in the dog's time. And I would just chill out during MEPET because I found it quite relaxing. I found it almost like meditation. And I would sometimes put meditation music on for me and the dog and like nice calming spray in the air and a little bit of vet bed for the dog. And I would just be sitting and just swaying from side to side and I'd be chilling out at the same time. And it's that like energy exchange. I think if the dog can feel that you're relaxed, then they relax too. Whereas I find with the grooming, because you haven't asked the dog, you know, can I have your paw please so I can cut your nails or can I trim around your bum hole? You know, the dog's sometimes upset by some of the things that you're doing. Whereas because with the teeth cleaning, you might be sitting with that dog for 20 minutes or so, just working on the teeth, it becomes quite like a relaxed state for you and the dog. That's what I've found anyway. But I would say your first session an hour and subsequent sessions, probably about 20 minutes really, 20 minutes to half an hour. So once I had had a few sessions with the dog, and you find that the more sessions you do and the whiter the teeth get and the less plaque and tartar there is on the teeth, the less time you need with that dog. So sometimes your maintenance sessions that are every 6 weeks, because you're working on quite clean teeth, they might only be 10 minutes long. But I definitely wouldn't charge any less for your maintenance sessions. But you will find that the sessions are shorter, the more that the results come in. So when you're working on teeth like this, the sessions won't take as long.
Thank you.
Has everybody here got a toothbrush? There's some people.
I'm invest.
Looking to buy the starter pack.
Yeah, the starter pack. Are you a groomer or a dog owner?
A groomer. I've just started up, so it's something that I was going to add on to grooming.
It is a really good add-on. And like when I started with the MEPET, I must have seen it at Master Groom a good 12 months before I bought it. And I think what was putting me off initially was the price, because at the time it was £200, but like literally all you got for your £200 was the brush. You didn't get any of the extras that you get now. Whereas now the price has come down a little bit. You get your toothbrush and you get loads of extra stuff for like, you know, £200-£250. So I've got a deal on at the moment where you get the training. I think you get six pastes, you get like 10 brush heads, rosewood sticks, leaflets, you get everything. I think it's £249. So affordability wise, it is a bit more affordable than it was. But at that time, I just felt it was a little bit out of my reach. And so I sat on the idea for 12 months. And then what made me bite the bullet, Wayne from Sizzy Yappy, he came to my salon and did a seminar. And he was talking about the toothbrush and how good it was. And at that point, I just thought, do you know what? I'm just going to bite the bullet. I'm going to get this toothbrush. I think I bought it on a credit card, actually, at the time. Not that I'm promoting credit cards, because I think they're awful. but at the time, I used my credit card to get the MEPET toothbrush on. But in my first month alone, I made £750 off the toothbrush. So it more than paid for itself, 2.5 times over. So I was really chuffed with that. And my salon was based in a little rural Northumberland town. So it's not particularly affluent. The people in the town don't have great deals of money, but they are really good at looking after the dogs. So I was quite lucky that my clients were all pet lovers, and they were all quite responsible at looking after the pets. So yeah, I was quite lucky, and I was quite blown away that my little toothbrush made me that much in its first month, and it made me like £8,000 in its first year. And then from that, like now, the toothbrush has become my full-time like job. And I never ever thought when I bought my first toothbrush 4 years ago that the MEPET would take me this far and that I would end up doing this as a job. And you know, leave my grooming salon behind, but it's just, it is, it's becoming so much more popular now. I think clients are a lot more aware that they can get their teeth cleaned at the groomers, and they're asking for a lot more. So it is a really good, I think it's a really good string to add to your bow for anyone that's got a pet business.
Can I ask, you probably get this a lot, but how do you actually know if the toothbrush is working? Because obviously it's so silent.
Yeah, this is something that comes up quite a lot. The only way that you know it's working really is by that green light. There's a few little urban myths floating around. Some people will say, you know, if you put it in water, you should see some bubbles coming out and ripples on the water. That's an urban myth. It's not true. So the only way is by that green light. There's no motion, there's no vibration, there's no sound. But what I would say, if you want to try it out for yourself, if you've got a toothbrush at home, is put a clean brush head on, put some paste on and some water, and then just do your own teeth. So the Emmy Pet paste, it tastes of bubble gum, so it's actually quite pleasant to use. But if you have your own human toothpaste that you'd prefer to use, you can use that and just give it a go. And then afterwards, you'll feel how fresh that your teeth and gums feel. That's what I used to do with my toothbrush, because I wanted to try it out and see what the sensation was for the dogs. And yeah, it made my teeth feel really clean. But now I've got the human version for myself. But when I first started, I tried the dog version of my teeth. Nikki, do brush heads last for as long as the bristles are straight? Yes. So what Nikki's asking is, how long do the brush heads last for? I know that some people would say change it every 25 times. What I say is that because the ultrasonic waves sterilize the bristles as they work, so the ultrasonic waves sterilize, so they sterilize the gums, deep clean all the bacteria, so they also self-sterilize as it's working. So for that reason, because every dog has their own individual brush head and you're not using the brush head between clients, then all you need to do after you've used it is run it under the tap, and then blot it with kitchen towel, and you've got a protective sleeve cap that you can fit over there, and then just store it away. And because these are individual to every dog and the bristles are being sterilized every time it works, then I would say only replace these if the bristles are getting all splayed. Because these bristles work as little conductors, if you like, so they're working like little antennas, they transport the ultrasonic waves that come to the piezo chip and they come up here. So for that reason, your bristle health is really, really important. So you need to make sure that your bristles are all straight, because what will happen if your bristles get chewed by a dog and they break and they're no longer going to transport your ultrasonic waves up them? This will flash red, and that's flashing red to tell you that your bristles are broken and it needs to, you need to get a new brush head. But the brush heads, those cost about £5 each if you buy them in bulk. So yeah, I would always put the price of the brush head onto the client. So when I do an intro session, I build the cost of the brush head into the initial session. And then I have a separate disclaimer that they sign, and it just says if their dog breaks any of the bristles or chews the bristles, the client is responsible for buying another brush head. Because you might have a particular dog that likes to chew brush head, and it might go through about 5. You shouldn't have to be paying for that. That should be the client. I haven't met a dog that chewed through 5 brush heads, thankfully. But the key is, if the dog's starting to nibble and gnaw at the brush, just take the brush out. and just sort of correct them and then go back in again. Because you do get some dogs that like to have a little bit of a sly, sneaky nibble.
So will the toothbrush tell you if the pins are faulty?
Yeah. So if there's a flashing red light there, what I would initially suspect, if all of your bristles look healthy, what I would initially suspect is just that your battery is running low. So you can pop it on the docker, and then that should go back to the blue charging light. If it's still flashing red after you put it on the docker, the charger, then that would indicate to me that there's a problem here with the brush head. And the problem could be either splayed bristles or it could be a damaged piezo chip, microchip that's in there. The beauty of the EmmyPet is your piezo chip, which is really important. It helps, once the ultrasonic waves pass up here, it hits the piezo chip, and that's what creates all the nano bubbles, which help to remove the impurities from and the bacteria from the dog's mouth. The piezo chip's really important, but it's in there. Now, the other brand, there's Cleany Teeth on the market as well. Their piezo chip's further down in their handset, but with the EmmyPet, our piezo chips are in the head. The beauty of that is if the piezo chip becomes damaged, you only have to replace the brush head, and that costs £5. Whereas if your piezo chip was in the handset, it's a lot more costly to replace. So that's one of the benefits of...
Is the toothbrush waterproof?
Yeah, I would say it is. Obviously, I wouldn't like submerge the whole thing in water, but yeah. definitely this part of it here is fine to run under the tap. It's all like water sealed and everything like that. These are your pinpoints here. So obviously, I wouldn't get these brush heads and then like submerge them in like cleaning solution or cleaning fluid or anything like that, because you've got your points there. So when it's on, it is pretty watertight. So even if you're running it under a tap, even if the water got over there, it would be okay. But this part here is your charging, where you charge it. I would try not to get water on there. So just being a bit careful, but it's fine to run that bit under a tap.
It just concerns me as when you don't have the brush head on, it still shows green. So you don't know if it's actually transferring to the brush head, if that makes sense.
You are supposed to charge if you've got the second generation toothbrush. You should always be charging it with the brush head on, because even if it's showing green and even if it seems like it's charging, it doesn't always get a full charge because it's not connecting up with the piezo chip. So the advice is always to charge it with the brush head on, because what I've found is groomers and pet professionals, if they've been charging the brush on the docker without this on, it'll go for so long and then it'll just like conk out, and the groomers are like thinking that the toothbrush is broken. And I say, have you been charging it with the brush head on? And they're like, well, no. And then I say, charge it with brush head on, and then it's fine after that. So it's quite important to charge it with that on.
So would the brush body, if you say, would it tell you if the pins were damaged that actually joined to the brush head?
I would imagine if there was any damage to the actual handset, then yeah, I would imagine that this bit would flash red just to indicate that there's some sort of connectivity issue. If you buy an EmmyPet handset from EmmyPet or from a reputable distributor, it does come with a 2-year warranty against mechanical defect or mechanical failure, and that covers your charging dock. And it also covers your handset, your device, and that covers it for 2 years. So yeah, if you get it off a selling page or you get a secondhand one, then obviously you haven't got that cover, but you do have the 2-year warranty on the against any mechanical defects of the product, which is really good.
Thank you.
Anastasia, you mentioned there about the nano bubbles. I don't get them. Like that.
Yeah, you won't see them with your naked eye because they're microscopic nano bubbles. So you won't see them with your naked eye, but those are, it's the nano bubbles on the end of the toothbrush that removes all the impurities and the bacteria and everything.
Okay. Because I've been literally waiting for some bubbles to appear.
No. You shouldn't see them with your naked eye, but I think it was German University, because obviously MEPET's from Germany, they actually looked at the nanobubbles under a really high, like a high-end microscope, and they actually took photographs of the nanobubbles to prove that the nanobubbles existed. I've got the document of it as well. It's yeah, it is a real thing, but you won't see them with your naked eye.
Okay.
Oh. Manuela, are you grooming? I thought I seen you still at work. I thought I seen you on the video before. Are you grooming dogs? Manuela's in Portugal. She's maybe busy. Yes, she is. Bless you. What time is it over there? I'm trying to blow drying. I'm glad that you've got your volume off then, if you're busy blow drying. All right. What I really like about this as well that I found is less wear and tear on your body. So I find the MEPET a lot less physically straining than the grooming, because you're just sitting there really, and you're just moving the toothbrush from tooth to tooth to tooth. And like I say, I found it quite relaxing. So most of the dogs that I was cleaning their teeth were really chilled and really relaxed. But I find it a lot less wear and tear, because dog grooming can be really physically demanding. So I found this a much quicker, easier way of making money. The clients get satisfaction from it. You get satisfaction from it. And also you're helping dogs. You're helping dogs' teeth improve and preventing it before it gets to that real like point of no return, you know, where the dog has to go to the vets and have extractions and things. And it does get to that point of no return, and you'll probably come across, if some of you are using MEPET in your own salon, you'll come across some cases where you're like, oh my God, I can't help this dog. This dog needs to see a vet. And it's just really important to have that confidence. If something doesn't feel right in your gut and you think those teeth are too far gone, the dog needs to see a vet, I would always err on the side of caution and make sure that your client goes and see the vet first, because I wouldn't tackle teeth that are, you know, receding gum lines, signs of infection, signs of really bad gingivitis and that sort of thing. Because again, you see some groomers tackling teeth that really need to go and get a vet dental. And it's just, there's loads of teeth out there. So there's loads of sets of teeth. So for every dog that you turn away and send to your local vet, there's going to be loads of dogs still coming for your service that are your ideal MEPET clients. And it's your reputation as well. So you don't want to start working on a dog's teeth and doing, you know, 3 and 4 sessions and then unearth something going on underneath the tartar that you didn't notice because you took the dog on and you shouldn't have really took the dog on. And you might unearth something in session 3 or session 4, and then your client's going to be really annoyed because they've spent so much money on the MEPET and then they have to go down the vets. So you're much better at the beginning if you think something is outside of the realms of MEPET possibilities, then just send them to the vet.
When you do the first session, do you aim to do all the teeth, or do you focus on the fang teeth, or, you know, the ones that are generally the worst ones that you see?
So I would always go around all of the dog's teeth, because that promotes your gum health, and it's really important to get those ultrasonic waves working into your gum line. If there's a particular bad area that you want to target, you can focus more of your attention in the session on that area, but always go around the teeth at least once, and then you can focus on the teeth that need the extra work.
And that's top and bottom? Yeah.
Yeah.
Is it inside and out?
The ultrasonic waves get through all the crevices, so they do the underside of the teeth as well. It might take a little bit longer if there is stains on the underside. But what I would usually do in those cases, because it is a real struggle to actually do the underside of dog's teeth because it's really fidgety and they get quite tickly, I use this Orozyme gel. So it's just like a veterinary enzymic gel. It's got a mild abrasive formula, so if you put it between your finger and thumb and you go like that, it feels like tiny, tiny little grains of sand. So it almost like polishes the teeth. So if you've got some staining or some plaque on the underside, you can just rub a little bit of Orozyme. You can send your client home with a tube of that, and you can get them to do it each night after the dog's last meal of the day. And they can just put it on with the finger and rub it on, and that can help with staining in particular areas. So if you've got like bad teeth, the molars at the back, the client can be doing homework, so they can be take the gel home with them and be applying that daily. And then it gives the client a sense of ownership of the dog's dental care routine. So it means that they're doing something at home as well to contribute to the dog on its EmiPet teeth journey. It just makes them feel like they're doing their part, but it also accelerates the results if the client can be doing something at home to help as well.
How much would you sell it for to a client?
So I sell it to my clients for £12 a tube, and £10 for a tube if they buy 5 tubes together. That's to my EmiPet dog groomer clients. I would recommend that you upsell it for at least £15 a tube, so you don't make a massive markup on it. It's more about getting the client to do something at home and getting the speedier results.
Okay. Anastasia, what age would you say to start this for a dog?
You can do it from as soon as the puppies have had their vaccinations. So from like sort of 12 weeks and onwards. But I would, it's perfectly safe to use on puppies. The only thing is, obviously, puppies lose their teeth, so you might not want the client to have like loads of sessions, because it's more about getting the dog used to it. So if you have puppy packages in your salon, you could maybe build like a teeth clean element into it, and it's more just about acclimatizing them to it. And I do find puppies a lot more amenable. So you know yourself, when you get a pup in the salon, the first time they come, they're sort of like, oh yeah. And they can be a lot more easy to train if they come in earlier. So yeah, I would definitely build something in if you have puppy packages at your salon.
Okay, thank you.
Oh, love your dog, Angie.
Just come up and say hello.
Oh. Right, I'm just looking at the time, and I was going to keep it quite short and sweet, but then I like to talk as well. So if anybody's got any other questions, then now's the time to ask them. Otherwise, I will say good night and go back and see what my toddler's doing downstairs. Someone is watching her, by the way. I've got a babysitter around, so she's not just running around feral.
I was just looking at if I ordered a package, how do I go about, where do I order it from you? Or
So do you follow my social media page, the Dog Tooth Fairy?
I've messaged you earlier on Instagram.
All right, okay. Have I replied?
Yeah, you have.
All right, okay. Yeah, we'll just message on Instagram and then I can send you all the details about everything.
Okay.
Cool.
Thanks. Hi, Bella. You've been very helpful.
I hope that's been useful. And I do have a support group. I don't know if you're all on it, but it's specifically aimed at pet professionals. It's called Emmy Pet Made Simple with the Dog Tooth Fairy, and it's on Facebook. And I try to put like as much useful things on there as I can about the Emmy Pet. And there's 1,300 people in there. A lot of them are dog groomers, pet professionals, and they're all really good at answering questions in that community as well. So that is a free Facebook group that you can join. And then, you know, you can always WhatsApp me or send me a message, and I can always help with any questions that you've got about the Emmy Pet. Oh, look at Manuela's little doggy. It's so cute. Oh. It's making me miss dog grooming momentarily. Oh. Oh.
Well, am I able to ask questions tomorrow?
Yeah, that's fine, because you're doing my training tomorrow, aren't you? Yeah. Because
today
No, that's fine. So on the training, at the end of the training, the Q&A usually isn't this long. There's usually 30 minutes of Q&A, so you'll be able to ask any questions, Manuela, that you've not been able to ask tonight because you've been busy. So yeah, there'll be 30 minutes of Q&A on tomorrow's training.
I'm going to start the training with my three dogs.
Yes.
They are all three feet. And then I will the band on, but only for my clients, not for friends.
Yeah.
They are all regular, and I know them, and then
yeah.
I think it's
going to
be easier for both.
Yeah, it's a lot less scary when you're working on your clients that you know really well. It's a bit more comforting when you're working on teeth of dogs that you already know. So yeah, I think that's a good idea. Right. Well, yeah, I think that's a good idea, especially when you're just starting out as well, because you know, we all need these to work with. We don't want to lose any fingers or anything. These are your bread and butter, yeah. And you make money with your hands.
I only do small breeds.
Yeah.
And I don't do aggressive dogs.
Mm-hmm.
This is my zen moment for me and for them.
Yeah. I think like each to their own. And I know there's dog groomers out there that like take on the trouble dogs that a lot of groomers say no to. But it's all a personal, me myself, when I was a groomer, I didn't like doing the aggressive dogs because there was only myself and I lived on my own and had my mortgage and my salon bills. And I thought, I don't want a dog taking me to the, you know, me ending up in hospital or something, because how would I pay the bills? So I was very much like, yes, you, where I just like the small and the medium dogs, and
this is just a part time. I work during the day and only groom at this time.
Yeah. Oh, that dog's so okay. Cute.
So all right, see you tomorrow.
I have to
finish this boy.
See you later.
Yeah.
Right, thank you so much, everyone.
Thanks, Anastasia.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Cheers.